Hello, everyone. My name is Austin Wagger, and I am a Senior Advisory Analyst at Info-Tech Research Group. It's my pleasure to welcome you to our ongoing series in which we highlight the use cases that are driving AI. And today, we're lucky enough to be joined by Patrick Obeid, the founder and CEO of ESG Flow. Thank you, Patrick, for joining us today.
Thank you, Austin, for having me. I'm excited for this conversation.
Yeah, likewise. We're excited to learn more about ESG Flow. So maybe that's a good place for us to start. Maybe you can give us a background of what exactly ESG Flow does and the value you bring your clients.
Absolutely. So my thesis is we're going to have to build the sustainability data industry the same way we've built the financial industry centuries ago. We are lucky that we have the power of AI today to build this with the right mindset, with the right philosophy, with the right level of scalability, modularity, auditability, precision, and traceability that AI can offer. And that's what we're doing at ESG Flow. So we use AI to extract data, normalize it, and process it into what I call audit-ready metrics. So in the financial world, a dollar is a dollar. In the non-financial world, it's a lot more complex than that. You have thousands of metrics in most cases, and the raw data sits in different formats. Sometimes it's invoices, sometimes it's an extract from your procurement system, sometimes it's geospatial data from which you're going to get biodiversity data. And the intent is to be able to normalize that, process that into metrics. I'm happy to give examples shortly, but that's at a high level what we do. Our core focus in the next 12 to 18 months is compliance. So a lot of companies have to go through the reporting process of externally communicating their data, and they have to make sure they have precise data that they're communicating. And then in the medium to long term, I'm in the decision science space. So I'm going to use that robust, precise foundations that we're going to build for businesses to be able to help businesses make better decisions with a 360-degree view of financial and non-financial data combined.
Amazing. I know you mentioned there that you use the AI to extract data, to normalize it, to process it. Curious, what type of AI models are you leveraging with ESG Flow?
Yeah, fantastic question. So let me give you a few use cases to get to bring this to life.
Absolutely.
The first thing is imagine having utility invoices, for example, water bills, waste bills. All of them sit in an unstructured format. Sadly, OCR alone doesn't work because it's extremely hard to zero shot data extraction from these unstructured data, from unstructured documents. Therefore, what we've built is a way to augment that OCR with a technology that allows us to understand that data, contextualize that data, and make sure that you're getting the right data from those documents. So that's an example of how we do it. Then we understand where, for example, where the electricity is coming from. And then in real time, you are able to match that normalized data into the right emission factor, getting you an output, which in this case is tons of greenhouse gas emissions. Another exciting example is getting data from your procurement systems. So let's say you're buying tons of steel from supplier X in China or in Spain. The ability to take that reading from your procurement system, which by the way, in most cases does not include mass data, find the relevant mass data from other sources, then match that to the right emission factor based on where you purchased the steel and from whom, is something that will take environmental consultants thousands of hours to parse through thousands of your suppliers and do it manually. So with the power of machine learning, we're able to more intelligently match that data to the right emission factor and get you an output. There's so many more places where we use AI, like anomaly flagging, and like decision making. But this is just, a few examples of what we're doing today.
Absolutely. Happy you provided those few examples as well. I know you mentioned utility invoices, procurement systems. Are there any other use cases ESG Flow can extend to?
Yeah, absolutely. So one thing I forgot to mention is that we are sector focused. That is a bet I made early on. And I believe the best way to build this platform from the ground up is by and be able to add value immediately to our customers is by focusing on a sector. I chose manufacturing, discrete manufacturing specifically, for many reasons. I'm happy to elaborate later. But because of that, we're starting to see a lot of product synergies. So a few more examples of where we use AI. Some customers are already using the data that we've given them to make better decisions on how to optimize their supplier spend. So being able to generate those levels of insight by using the data foundation that we've provided those customers and allowing you to generate intelligent recommendations on how you can improve your spend on your suppliers and then at the same time improve your carbon emissions baseline is something that we were able to do, again, with the help of AI. Another area where we're using it is automatically filling reports and understanding how reports are interconnected. So a lot of customers have to go through CSRD reporting, which is, I would call it the vanguard of sustainability reporting. And by filling that, you're automatically filling other reports. So understanding how different reports are interconnected, and by being able to fill a question here, you're automatically filling a question that is phrased differently there, is something where we're using AI. Another one is automatically filling that CSRD report. So by being able to, you know, think of it as Gen AI for sustainability reporting, and a lot of it right now we're using to be able to fill, you know, your CSRD report. Another exciting thing is anomaly flagging. I touched upon that earlier, but today on our KPMG is already on our platform, and we have a partnership with the other key auditors as well. We've built this from the ground up with a few of the big auditors, so we understand what metrics these, you know, outside verification agencies are looking for, and then we're able to help the customers identify those anomalies, those gaps, those duplicates early before they have to go through an assurance process with the intent of reducing their audit fees and hopefully reducing risk and allowing them to ensure that the data they're reporting on externally is accurate to avoid greenwashing and other penalties that they may be subject to.
So I know you mentioned that you're sector focused and that you're specifically focusing on discrete manufacturing. So curious within that, you know, who are your target customers? How would you define your exact market within discrete manufacturing?
Totally. That's fantastic. I mean, in 3 years, my hope is to be able to work with, you know, hopefully all manufacturers globally. And working with a $20 million manufacturing company in Italy to, you know, a $300 billion company like Costco that, you know, for many people who don't know that, Costco is also a manufacturing company because I think more than 50% of what they sell, they manufacture themselves. So ideally, I want to cover the whole supply chain and the whole, you know, companies from different sizes. In the short term, so the next 12 to 18 months, if I were to choose my next like 100 customers, I would tell you where I would love to be able to grow where we are already playing. So we have a furniture manufacturing company. We have a machinery and equipment manufacturing company. We have a home improvement manufacturing company. We have a construction equipment company. We have a construction company. We have a real estate company. We have a battery manufacturing company. We have a fabric manufacturing company, a bottling, so glass manufacturing company. So if you look at your supply chain, and if 50% plus of what you buy comes from the following raw materials, then we're the right solution for you. And those raw materials are, you know, steel, fabrics, wood, cement, and like plastic and glass. And if, you know, 50% plus of what you buy fits, you know, one of those six criteria, then we should talk.
Amazing. I know you mentioned there are quite a few of the companies you work for or the types of companies that are, you know, clients of ESG Flow. Curious, within these organizations, who is the primary user of your tool?
Yeah, fantastic question as well. So we designed this with cross-functionality from the ground up. The main user is the sustainability manager or the chief sustainability officer or whomever is wearing that hat in the organization. So think of us as a sustainability solution as a service. That's basically what we are. We are an extension of your sustainability team, hopefully augmenting and completely automating the back-end data collection, normalization, and processing. That being said, I would say you need to have way more functions in that platform. And then on purpose, you know, the more functions you have, the cheaper our product becomes because we want to incentivize having more teammates, internal and external. So today we have internal audit. We have your legal team, you have your compliance team, you have your finance team, your sustainability and ESG team. In some cases, we have transformation, strategy, and so many more. supply chain, procurement could be there, HR for social data, the person leading governance and ethics, diversity, equity, and inclusion. So your marketing and sales in some cases, depending on how you want to use the data. So really our intent is to have everyone on that platform and slowly take them away. Like facility managers, site managers are there as well. Take them away from purely data collection towards what I call decision science, basically, and being able to help guide their day-to-day practice. My bet is in 5 years, sustainability is simply called business strategy, right, or just business. And the earlier you can get your team involved and making sustainability a more integrated part of your day-to-day business, the more you're going to succeed in the next 5 years. In addition to having internal stakeholders, you also have external stakeholders on the platform. So you can extend this to your consultants. You can extend this to your like Deloitte, KPMG, PwC. You can extend this to your auditor. So also PwC, Deloitte, KPMG. You can extend this. We haven't launched like the next set of features, but you can even extend this to your customers and suppliers. You can extend this to your banks, which will now use that data to be able to predict the interest rate that they would give you on the next loan that they will provide you. So the opportunities are limitless, but this is who we have today. And my hope is to grow across the value chain over time.
Absolutely. So I know you just mentioned there your goal is to grow across the value chain, but just wondering, in the present, what levels of usage and adoption are you seeing?
All the functions that I mentioned plus external auditors are there already. So external audit already provide assurance on our customers' data on our platform. And that saves them time, saves the customers time, and creates more levels of transparency across the board. We haven't launched our supplier data exchange platform yet. It's being piloted right now with 3 customers. One of them is a Fortune 500 in this country. And the intent is to extend that, hopefully, to our other customers today. We already have around 30 customers. All of them have signed at least a 3-year subscription and are thinking of us as a long-term partner. This is a big decision you have to make. So for anyone who's listening who has to make that decision, just make sure you ask about precision, traceability, auditability, all very important features or design principles, I call them, not features. Today we have, for most of our customers, all of these functions that I mentioned are actively using our platform. We're seeing daily time savings and cost savings for the ones that used to use external consultants to do the math earlier. And we're starting to generate reports. We're very early because, CSRD reporting is due for the first time in 9 months for the bigger companies in Europe. And a lot of them have already achieved full compliance on our platform. And we have generated the first set of reports. We have gone through multiple audits, internal and external, with our customers. And in fact, one of our customers just released their annual report with our data. 2 more customers are doing that by the end of this month, March 2024. And hopefully so many more to come. We are at the beginning of a long-term revolution here.
Definitely. No, it's exciting to see. This all sounds fantastic as well. And I know that you prepared a demo for us. So we'd love to see a little bit more how the ESG flow works. Do you think we could dive into that now?
Yeah, absolutely. Let's do it. I'm going to quickly show you how this works and show you the power of our platform. I won't have time to do the full demo today just because I think I will need more than an hour to go through the entire set of features. I'm going to show you the key features today. I won't be able to dig into scope 3, but if you're interested, and I'm sure you are, because it's on the minds of many of our clients and customers, please do feel free to reach out. For today, I'm going to show you high level how the compliance platform looks like, and then I'm going to show you the power of our data extraction capabilities. So very quickly, as I said, you have these different frameworks. By filling one, you're filling another. The CSRD requires you to fill 1,000 metrics, but very quickly, you have to conduct what you call a double materiality assessment to identify which ones are actually material or relevant to your business. Basically, what we're building here is, think of it as a Venta for those who know who Venta is, or OneTrust, or think of it as a compliance platform, but for sustainability. And that's the world we're headed into. On the back end, we also do a lot of the data collection, as I mentioned earlier. By filling one report, you're automatically filling the rest. So by filling your CSRD report, you fill your CDP report, you fill your SEC report. You can have any report you want here. One of our customers has already 100 reporting frameworks. HSBC has one, your customers has one, your suppliers have one, your investors have one, your CFO wants one, your CEO wants one, your board wants one. So there are many reports you could have here, and I don't want you spending your year filling reports. I want to take away that time from you so you can focus on what matters, which is driving change. By going into CSRD, you can see the different metrics and which ones are recommended and which ones are material. And then you can quickly see, for example, like scope 2. And then scope 2, which is part of greenhouse gas emissions, you go in and then you have different types of inputs that you need for that specific metric. So what type of value do you have for site A? What type of values do you have for site B? Everything is built with assurance. So you can upload spreadsheets, set up integration, set up surveys, input any documents that you want to use as a supporting document for this specific metric. I'm going to show you the magic of this on the back end. So you go in, as I said, having a compliance platform just for the sake of compliance without the back end doesn't really eliminate the pain points of data collection. So this is, we've taken it one step further and we do the data collection on your behalf. Let's say you're a manufacturing company with dozens of sites. You have production sites, offices, warehouses all over the world. You have a warehouse here. You want to be able to understand where you get different data from. Now, in terms of where you get that raw data, in most cases, it's going to be utility bills. In this specific case, you know, we've uploaded those. I had a demo right before this. So you can see where different invoices are. So if you go in here, you see on the left, you have an invoice. On the right, you have the invoice data. So what we're doing here is we're extracting from the invoice all the information that you need for this, for non-financial data. And some of it is financial, like the cost, for you to be able to submit reporting and eventually drive better decisions. In this specific case, you see start date and end date of the invoice. It's an electricity invoice. We know the type. We know the usage in kilowatt hour, which we're reading from here. And then you also know the cost, and then in real time, and the cost is important because you want to get eventually to non-financial data and financial data together so you can generate better insights. Like very quickly, we are able to identify savings in terms of kilowatt hours per dollar of revenue for some of our companies that we're working with. And then you also get in real time the conversion from that raw data in kilowatt hour to tons of CO2 emissions using the right emission factor, which we got here from eGrid. All of this is built with auditability from the ground up. So let's, for example, see one that requires review. Let's take this one. You go in, you see the invoice data on the left, and then you see the data here on the right. This is an example of we are able to flag a gap, flag an anomaly. So for example, here you can see the usage is more than 62.5% different from the last bill uploaded from the utility provider. So it's the system is flagging that this could potentially be wrong. Mm-hmm. So you go in, you see start date, end date, you see the usage, and then you see the conversion, and the conversion is actually right. So what we're doing here is we're comparing per day what the emissions are per site to be able to tell you if you know, the data is correct or incorrect. And in fact, you can even quickly see here that for the month of June and July 2022 is a lot lower than the month of June, which is a lot lower than the month of March and April. But we are able to quickly detect these trends to ensure that data is accurate, and it will quickly flag to different stakeholders across the company to verify that data. Have so many more features, like the ability to be able to see intensity data on a company level, on a site level. You're able to see emission summary broken down. You're able to see all the emission factors on the back end. You have a dashboard as well. And as I said earlier, you can manage users. So you can have people from all across the company, like data providers, sustainability managers, but also external auditors for your review. Remember, all of this is with the intent of filling this report. Mm-hmm. You have so many more metrics, and the intent is for us, we have automated many, like the ones I showed you, all of scope 3, waste, water. We've already automated qualitative extraction from ethics policies and other policies that will allow you to fill all of this non-financial data that you need for CSRD reporting. As I also said, by filling one report, you're filling another. And, you know, we won't be able to go through the entire process now, but by filling these different types of data, you're able to go back and then see that automatically you filled your SEC report, which is now required for accelerated filers and large accelerated filers in this country.
Amazing. Patrick, this was great. Thank you so much. I know, like you mentioned, there's so much more to go into. I'm sure a lot of our members will be reaching out to do just that and see exactly the extendability of ESG flow. But I also know that some of them are probably curious about your implementation. So maybe we can touch on the steps clients need to take to fully implement your solution. Is there anything they need to be considered about in terms of fine-tuning or training your AI?
That's a really good question. Today we have around 97% precision for everything that we've built thus far. And on purpose, we're not trying to grow fast, but we're trying to do this slow before we go fast.
Right.
So the implementation, and we can onboard as many as 300 sites a week. So
okay.
Some of our companies have 3,500 sites on our platform. Some have 100, some have 5. Most companies that we work with have at least 1,000 suppliers, but we also, you know, as I said, are also moving to help smaller companies now because my intent is to grow within the sector, not necessarily focusing on a specific customer size. We will do all the handholding up until this is fully automated. So you can expect that the workload that you're currently doing is immediately going to drop by 30, 40, 50, 60%, depending how much of this is part of your day-to-day. And then the intent is for you to shift towards focusing on insights and setting initiatives, setting the pace, communicating across the government. There's so much more that sustainability leaders should be doing today, and our intent is to enable them for success. Our implementation onboarding is extremely seamless. We do all the handholding. We understand that not everyone knows where to go to find that data. And then we'll work with you in the first 4 to 6 weeks to ensure that all of your data sources are added to our platform. This is also a continuous improvement process. So you may not have the visibility today to say, hey, I want to get extracts from my performance reviews to determine some of the metrics under S, for example. So we will work with you over time to continuously add those. A lot of our customers don't know exactly what reports they will need to comply with. Like, suddenly they're being asked by HSBC for this report, and suddenly they're being asked by their customer for this report. So we are there. We understand that for the first 24 months, in addition to this being a SaaS platform, we will provide consulting services that we don't charge for. So we waive the fees because we understand, because our thesis is this, you should not be paying consultant for this. So we will do this for you in the first 24 months until this is a fully automated play for you and your organization.
Fantastic. Just to dive in on that, more the pricing piece, I suppose, you mentioned earlier on that the more functions, you know, your users adopt, the cheaper the solution is. So maybe you could just explain your pricing model to us.
Yeah, totally. I have three modules. We have I call them base or starter, premium, enterprise. And the difference in pricing depends on many things. But just to keep it super simple for you at a high level, there are, you know, we have, you know, 4 SKUs. There's the compliance suite that includes reporting frameworks, collaboration, cross-framework sharing, and auditor portal. And starter is up to 1 report, premium is up to 5 reports, and then enterprise is unlimited. Then data collection suite, so we have the data extraction, the anomaly flagging, integration, surveys, supplier portal, sites, and suppliers. I don't want to get into the specific details, but if you have up to 20 sites, you're in the starter, up to 100 sites, you're in the premium, and unlimited is an enterprise. And then you have account, which is user seats, role-based access, secure login. And then all of them have unlimited user seats, unlimited role-based access, unlimited secure login, and unlimited onboarding and training services. I'm going to quickly show this sheet. Again, the price may change over time. You know, we're in the early stages of our journey. On average, the customer pays $50K to start, but some customers pay $100, depending on the size. Some customers have 91 businesses within their parent group using our platform. So the pricing, obviously, for that company was different. So you can see the price, you know, where you can start, the premium price and the enterprise price. On my point earlier, Austin, we provide incentives to have your auditor on our platform because it will make your journey more successful. And we want to enable you for success. So the earlier you can get the auditor involved, the better, the more money you save down the road, right? Because they're providing what I call assurance readiness. So I've given up to 50% discounts for customers that onboard their auditors as of day one. I have many auditors beyond the big companies, you know, the top four, that are all using my platform today. We also have local German and Italian and Swiss auditors on the platform. And we're trying to establish the same connection with a few Middle Eastern auditors. And hopefully, you know, in a few years, we have all the auditors in the world using our platform for assurance.
Absolutely. No, that'd be fantastic. I'm wondering maybe if we can shift focus now to your speed to value. What are you hearing from your clients in terms of ROI?
Yeah, totally. I mean, that's a good question. I always start, I think my team has heard this from me like at least 20 times in the last 90 days. No one's going to buy a software unless it does one of three things, at least: reduce costs, reduce risk, and increase revenue. We are in the cost reduction, risk reduction place for the next 12 months. And then we're already increased revenue for our customers, but we don't create that much value for everyone yet, but we want to move towards that world, you know, beyond April 2025. We're starting to see it now, but it's in the early stages of that being created. Cost reduction: companies spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on environmental consultants doing what I just showed you manually.
Yeah.
We do this at a fraction of the cost. Your teams within the organization are spending hundreds of hours, if not thousands of hours, collecting the data manually. We're eliminating that. A lot of companies use, and you also want to reduce your audit fees. I already see reduction in audit time up to 30% today, but we're going to go from 30 to 90% in the next 12 months as we get a SOC. We're going to get like a SOC report from one of the auditors that certify our platform, our systems, and think of it that way. Instead of auditing the numbers, you can now audit the system is audited. So we know what's coming in and what's going out is accurate. So an auditor would sample a lot fewer samples. So that we're going to get you immediately. So the price that I just showed you, customers are probably getting 5 to 10 times that value in the first 6 months alone. And I will not increase our prices. Like, this is me going on record, as long as I'm the CEO, you know, the prices that you saw, obviously they're going to change, but the intent is not to charge an arm and a leg, because my whole thesis is I want to build this whole system of records efficiently from the ground up. We save time across the organization, obviously, in terms of data gathering, data processing. And one of the features I didn't show you, which is the ability to wake up in the morning and have a set of tasks as a sustainability or data manager, like, I don't want you to have to chase people via email or follow up three times or call someone to train them how to do it. Everything will be on our platform. So you'll have videos that guide you. You'll have tasks for you to follow in the morning. And it's going to save time across the board for the entire company. So they can focus on what matters, which is driving change. We already help with revenue increase or stock value increase. So one of our customers used ours for MSCI rating improvement. And then with that, they were able to access a different set of funds from one of their existing investors and increase their stock value. This is around a $4 billion furniture manufacturing company based out of the United States, with presence in Europe. But more importantly, this is like, if you are a $100 million manufacturing company selling to Coca-Cola, and Coca-Cola is knocking on your door asking you for that data, very quickly they're going to ask you for assured data.
Right.
This is a massive cost for your business. Good luck staying alive if you don't go through that, though. So it is a must-have for companies. And by working with our platform, we're able to quickly generate off-the-shelf customer reports with verification, allowing you to maintain your existing business and hopefully opportunistically grow, because a lot of businesses are going to start shifting towards more sustainable suppliers. For that, we've been doing some work there. It's still not, I mean, the automatic customer report generation is on our platform, but I can't tell you specifically that we've increased revenue or maintained revenue for customers yet, but we are working very closely with our customers on that, and hopefully a lot more value to come in the coming years.
Absolutely. Wondering if we can maybe focus on some of the potential risks associated with AI. I know when a lot of people think about AI, that's where their mind turns to first, right? Whether it's, you know, data security, data privacy, hallucinations, you know, the accuracy of the solution. I know you had already touched on the accuracy of ESG Flow, but wondering if maybe you can touch on how your solution helps mitigate some of these other potential risks.
Yeah, absolutely. Can I can start by saying that, I mean, in less than a year, we have a lot higher precision than any consultant out there doing it manually. In fact, like, you know, even though it's not 100%, it's 97%. It's not perfect yet. It's a lot better than doing it manually because you're dealing with vast amount of data and you're not able to catch all the things that we caught. But yeah, I think the one thing that I'd like to do, I call it Pokayoke, which is error-proofing my platform. And again, it's a continuous improvement, right? Yeah. Process that we need to go through. In terms of the risks, I mean, again, we're super secure, super compliant. I really don't see risks in our business yet. I would say maybe one risk is not having the right, it's not an AI risk, it's more like an organizational risk, like okay. Not having the right stakeholders on the platform as of on day one is a risk for your business, not getting them involved in double materiality assessment. So I increasingly, I'm starting to feel, and I'm seeing this on a day-to-day basis, that the improvement opportunities that our customers flag are nothing to do with AI. Obviously, there's always ways we can use AI more to error-proof this, but the improvement opportunities are around make sure we have the right people on board, they have the right training, they understand the why. It's a communication risk. And if you're a company treating this as a check the box, you know, gives it to the compliance team, I don't want to hear about it ever again, that is the real risk for your business, because this needs to be an embedded part of your business. Otherwise, you're just not going to be doing business in 10 years. It is what it is. It's, again, sustainability is what I call business strategy. Yeah. So the risk that I see is, for example, not involving internal audit early on and not starting to stress test the numbers as of day one and waiting until the last responsible moment. Yeah. That is the risk. And I'm trying to redesign incentives to make sure that companies are incentivized to start early and auditors are incentivized to review the data early. But, you know, that's hopefully is a longer term journey that I'm on, and hopefully, you know, we will succeed.
Yeah. So speaking about longer term journeys, I know you'd mentioned already a few examples of kind of what's in the roadmap for ESG Flow. I know you mentioned, just for example, working on compliance in the next 12 to 18 months. But curious, in terms of your product vision, how else do you see ESG Flow growing in the near future?
For me, for the next 24 to 30 months, I want to stay hyper-focused on manufacturing and manufacturing-adjacent industries like construction and real estate that buy a lot of... So if 50, 60% plus of your Scope 3 purchase goods and services emissions come from manufacturing companies, then like we should chat. My value proposition, compliance and auditing are very important value adds that we bring to customers. Mm-hmm. But it is the foundation of your business, and there's so much more that you can do with that once you have all of the data in. So the immediate thing we're going to grow into after this in 2025, you know, once we go raise our next round, is to help you with driving better decisions. How can you optimize your supplier base? How can you strategically increase your market share in specific continents by using this as an edge? And using that set of data that you have that you historically never had. How can you increase customer employee retention? How can you make sure that you hold your suppliers accountable? How can you educate your suppliers to make sure that they are still in business in 2 years and you don't risk inflationary prices on your steel because suddenly, like, you know, steel has higher carbon tax and there's like fewer suppliers of steel and then suddenly price go up. Like, I think we have a big responsibility here towards each other, towards the world, towards our employees, towards our customers, towards our suppliers. And my hope is, in addition to reporting and auditing, which are extremely important activities, we find quicker ways for companies to use that data, that system of record that is now in-house, that historically was in the hands of consultants, taking their data, giving them a report. Now you have access to that historical data for the last few years. You have access to trends. And then together we can help you make better decisions. So my vision is we go into the decision science space. And the quicker we can do that, the faster the entire world can win.
Absolutely. I'm totally in agreement with that. Really just one last question here, Patrick, before I do let you go. There's a lot of organizations out there that are just beginning to formulate their AI strategies, you know, who may be on the fence about adopting a platform like ESG Flow that utilizes AI. What would you say to those companies or those individuals who are considering adopting a platform like ESG Flow?
Totally. Three thoughts. Thought number one is AI has been the most misused and overused term in the last 12 months. Don't get lost in the noise. Second thought is, specifically when it comes to data and parsing, extraction, normalization, and processing, and driving better insights and decision-making, which is the space that we're in, before you can start using AI, write down your workflows. Because what you want is to use AI to make your existing workflows better.
Right.
AI is not going to magically, it's not a magic recipe. It's a magic ingredient, but you still have to make the recipe work and start with that. And then add the magic ingredient to it. Define your use cases, define why you're doing what you're doing. Where are your data sources? What are the challenges that are existing today in the world where there's no AI, and how do you envision AI improving, automating, and expediting that process? I guess third piece of advice is start somewhere. Like it's again, because of the noise and because of the vastness of this world, I even find myself crippled most days, and it's important to just start somewhere. I really believe that, you know, it's consistency, it's baby steps, and it's slowly waking up and doing 1% more every day. You know, I always say 1.01 to the power 365 is equal 37. If you don't do that extra 1% every day, you're just stuck where you are, because totally. 1 to the power 365 is equal to 1. So you get 37 times more results by doing that extra 1% every day. And in today's world, that 365 is going to be even faster, and we're going to move exponentially faster. And just start somewhere. And if specifically for ESG, if there's anything, or non-financial data, if there's anything I can do to help, I'm happy to jump on the phone and help you brainstorm. I want to build a long-term business here and build long-term partners. And again, my vision is to become a platform used by all manufacturing, construction, and real estate companies.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Patrick, thank you so much. I really appreciate you taking the time to join us here today and for sharing your insights and just giving us really countless examples of how ESG Flow is able to deliver great value with AI to its clients. So thank you again for taking part.